Good afternoon. Oh, there we are. So we're so glad to have you back this afternoon in the Jerry Falwell Library for the second talk in our Spring Scholar Series, which is sponsored by us here in the Jerry Falwell Library, as well as by the Center for Apologetics and Cultural Engagement. So we're super excited to have you here, and just a few logistics in case you're not familiar with the building. If anyone needs to slip to the restrooms, they're right down this hallway. And at the end of the event, we'll be handing out some little cards for you with a URL that you can visit to give us feedback on the talk. We'd love to have that feedback from you. And without any further ado, I would like to introduce to you Dr. Chatreau, who is the Executive Director for the Center for Apologetics and Cultural Engagement here at Liberty University.
Thanks for being here for the afternoon session. This morning I gave a more formal introduction. I wanted to just give an informal one to Dr. Dockery. I had the pleasure of spending the afternoon with him and the rest of the morning with him. And what they say about him is true. I mentioned this morning his kindness, his humility, and I just want to add the interest he's taken in us at Liberty and in me personally and in the other colleagues I've introduced him to has been amazing. And I also want to thank him as we got together at lunch today with the provost team and some other people speaking into where we are at Liberty and just a wealth of wisdom and knowledge that he shared with us about research and as we're taking steps forward in thinking through research and thinking through faculty doing research as well as students. So Dr. Dockery, thank you for that, and thank you for being here with us. Let's give him a warm welcome.
Thank you, Josh. It's a genuine privilege to be on the Liberty campus today. I have enjoyed every minute of it, and your warmth and hospitality, you've been welcoming in every way, and I am so very grateful to you and to Cindy, to Dean Rice. You're very, you've opened your doors to me, and I'm just so grateful for what God is doing at Liberty University. It's a wonderful thing to behold. I admire the faculty and staff I've been able to meet today, as well as the students, and to see this wonderful facility is a great gift. I want to try, if I can, to take what we did this morning and take the conversation at lunch and see if I can connect some of these things together this afternoon. Under the heading of Evangelicals and Christian Higher Education, and talk about how we understand those things in light of a failure to see it holistically. Because sometimes we only see it experientially, and sometimes we only see it historically, and sometimes we only see it confessionally. And so I want to try to put some of those things together this afternoon, thinking about evangelical higher education, piety, confession, and scholarship. So here we go. Change and challenge characterized the world of Christian higher education in the second decade of the 21st century. We now live with a global awareness and new understanding of terrorism, war, the meaning of security. As we look around the globe, we observe a shift among the nations that will influence this new century. Questions abound regarding the economic influence of the Asian countries in general, China in particular, while similar concerns regarding financial stability are raised across Europe and North America. Brazil, South Korea, Nigeria, and other countries in the global south have become significant sources of strength for the advancement of the Christian faith in this century. Anyone interested in the future of evangelicalism and the future of Christian higher education will also want to keep an eye on these issues, but our time this afternoon is somewhat limited, so I want to focus in a different direction. The changes in higher education itself seem to be ever shifting in terms of focus, philosophy, methodology, and delivery systems. Economic, cultural, technological, and ecclesiological factors will also shape our work in the future in ways different from the past. These and other issues make our calling to provide distinctive, Christ-centered higher education in the 21st century more challenging than ever before. So what I want to do is not to explore each of these challenges in particular, but in light of them as a whole, I want to propose a future for evangelical higher education that seeks to more intentionally connect teaching, learning, research, and scholarship. Now, this is not about higher education in general, but about evangelical higher education. So first of all, we have to try to define that adjective. What does the word evangelical mean? Evangelicalism is a story of complexities. So who are these evangelicals that people on CNN and Fox are always talking about on election night? How should evangelicalism be understood in North America, in Great Britain, in Europe, in other parts of the world? What does evangelicalism have to do with politics, where we often hear it so often? Are there differences between mainline evangelicals and mainline Protestants? How should evangelicals be understood in light of the denominational distinctives that are maintained by Baptists and Lutherans and Presbyterians and Methodists and Assemblies of God and others? And what is the current state of evangelicalism before we try to understand evangelical higher education? Who are these evangelicals? They are men and women who love Jesus Christ, who love the Bible, who love the gospel message. They are gospel people. This kind of basic piety is key and foundational for understanding evangelicalism. A hallmark of the movement is a willingness to cooperate together in evangelism, missions, benevolence, and educational efforts. Evangelicalism is a cross-denominational movement that emphasizes classical Protestant theology, best understood today as a culturally engaged, historically shaped response to mainline liberalism on the one hand and reactionary fundamentalism on the other. Evangelicalism, as best understood, can be characterized by a big tent approach. From Lutherans to Anglicans, from Trinitarian Pentecostals to Evangelistic Methodists, from social justice Mennonites to tall steeple Presbyterians, from those who love the Gettys to those who love the Gaithers, from dozens of small denominations that dot the evangelical landscape, in addition to untold numbers, dozens and dozens, hundreds and hundreds of special interest parachurch groups. Evangelicals are heirs of the Reformation, heirs of 17th century Puritanism and Pietism, of the 18th and 19th century revivals and awakening movements, and particularly of the post-fundamentalists coming out of the middle of the 20th century between the modernist and fundamentalist controversies. Martin Marty, the great historian at the University of Chicago, says that looking at religion in America, one cannot miss evangelicalism. It would be like looking across the United States and missing the Rocky Mountains. The early 16th century movement, first called evangelicals, led by Martin Luther. We also know it as the Reformation. We are approaching its 500th anniversary. It was shaped by a search for answers to the meaning of justification and what is the basis for religious authority. The responses that were given in the 16th century were as follows. Justification is a declaration that believers are righteous by grace alone, through faith alone, in the atoning work and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the source of religious authority is primarily found in the Bible, not a bishop or a pope. Following the deaths of Martin Luther and Philip Melanchthon, 1560, the Reformation trajectory began to get off track at the end of the 16th century. Two important works representing the best of the pietists, among others, helped to bring renewal to this 17th century Christian movement. First of all was the movement that we know as Pietism from Philip Jacob Spener, and then from John Bunyan and Pilgrim's Progress. The Pietists proposed heartfelt religion, regular Bible study, consecrated prayer, mutual care in the churches as emphasis needed for renewal and spiritual health. And while we can connect the evangelical movement with the teaching of the apostles, with the early church consensus that developed through the great church councils, the Reformation of the 16th century, evangelicalism is perhaps best traced to the revivals of the 18th century. Many historians, including Doug Sweeney, in his fine work, The American Evangelical Story, point to the experiences of John and Charles Wesley with the Moravians, to the surprising work of God associated with Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield in the First Great Awakening. Though much has been made of the involvement of many evangelicals in cultural and political circles, including the extremely insightful work by Kenneth Collins called Power, Politics, and the Fragmentation of Evangelicalism, evangelicalism is best understood by its understanding as a confessional identity and by its pietistic heart. It's focused on the gospel, on personal conversion, on a commitment to the Bible, and on service and activism in behalf of others. Alistair McGrath, in his fine book on evangelicalism and the future of Christianity, suggests that there are six aspects of evangelicalism: a commitment to the supreme authority of Scripture, to the majesty and lordship of Jesus Christ as the only Savior for sinful humanity, to a belief in the Trinitarian God, including the important work of the Holy Spirit, the need for personal conversion, the priority of evangelism and missions, and the importance of Christian community. The Puritans, the Pietists, the Lutherans, the Reformers, put together, all in some ways emphasize these six things. The movement known as Puritanism, similar to Pietism, stressed conversion and grace and downplayed liturgy and sacraments, maintaining that a conversion to Jesus Christ impacted all of life. While seeking to address the spiritual decline in the Lutheran Reformed and Anglican movements, this experiential faith of the Puritans and the Pietists was the key, emphasizing prayer, warm-hearted fellowship, and evangelistic zeal. The best example of the Pietists were the Moravians, led by Count Zinzendorf. The Moravians sent missionaries to many lands decades before William Carey, who is often known as the father of modern missions. Further, the Pietists had a most significant influence on 18th century revivals, including the conversion account of John Wesley. So by the time we get to the end of the 18th century, the most evangelistic of the churches in Great Britain and in North America were the Baptist and the Methodist, clearly the fastest growing groups, even impacting the slave community. So as Joel Carpenter of Calvin College has observed, many African Americans found Jesus to be a rock in a weary land, who alone could set them free. In the final decade of the 18th century, William Carey set out for India, launching a worldwide missions movement that would shape what would truly become a global evangelicalism by the 21st century. These evangelical movements at the beginning of the 19th century look somewhat different than the Reformation some 300 or 400 years earlier. They were now having to answer questions of theology, confessional issues. Particularly do we find that in 19th century Princeton theology here in North America, led by Charles and A.A. Hodge, along with B.B. Warfield, who shaped the thought leaders of the day. Evangelicalism as a whole placed a greater emphasis on personal, warm-hearted, experiential faith as well as cooperation across denominational lines, aggressive evangelistic efforts, conversionist views of salvation, pious living, and revivalistic expectations. D.L. Moody became the most influential figure in this regard on both sides of the Atlantic in the 19th century, not only for his evangelistic preaching, but also for his social efforts, his commitment to urban renewal, as well as his understanding of transdenominational groups working together. So by the time of the Civil War in both the North and the South, Protestantism could be equated with evangelicalism, and evangelicalism could be equated with Protestantism. So much so that historian William McLaughlin has dared to say that the story of American evangelicalism during the 19th century is the story of America itself. How different than the way we would define that in 2016. With its emphasis on rugged individualism, laissez-faire economic theory, the Protestant ethic regarding both work, morality, and the millennial hope in the manifest destiny. By the end of the 19th century, however, that was all changing. Evangelicals saw the churches were losing their connection with the truth of the gospel, the message made clear in an inspired and authoritative Bible. And as the 20th century began, new movements were launched to revise, to renew, correct, and sometimes even to separate from established Protestant denominations, which evangelicals viewed as growing more and more liberal and more worldly. Prior to the Civil War, evangelicalism was understood to be the equivalent of Protestantism. After the Civil War, evangelicals wrestled with the changes taking place all around them, including Darwinism, naturalism, biblical criticism, post-slavery society, pragmatism, as well as the expanding urbanization and industrialization of the day. As the 20th century began, the modernist-fundamentalist controversy moved publicly into force. In 1910, the five fundamentals were clarified by the Northern Presbyterians as reflecting the earlier version spelled out by the Niagara Prophecy Conference. These five doctrinal tenets, which focused on the full and complete inspiration and authority of Scripture, the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, the atoning death and resurrection of Christ, the historical reality of biblical miracles, were aimed at the primary challenges of liberalism. The publication of the Fundamentals, which included 90 articles edited by R.A. Torrey, who helped to found Biola University, were well-reasoned, serious, calm, thoughtful, not shrill, and generally quite persuasive. The authors included what some considered to be more moderate voices, like James Orr from Britain and Southern Baptist theologian E.Y. Mullins. In 1919, however, fundamentalist leader William Bell Riley said the five fundamentals were not enough. He wanted also to stress separatism and different small factors of doctrine, lifestyle taboos, which continued to be distinguished for many aspects of fundamentalist movement nearly a century later. In 1922, Harris Emerson Fosdick in New York City preached his famous sermon at the First Presbyterian Church asking, "Shall the fundamentalists win?" To which he answered, "No." In 1923, representing a more conservative perspective, Princeton scholar J. Gresham Machen published Christianity and Liberalism, with the word "and" being key in the title, so that Machen treated the subject not as two different perspectives of one religion, but as two very different religions. In 1925, in Dayton, Tennessee, the Scopes trial gained attention of the nation. The fundamentalists won the battle, but seemingly lost the war. And prior to the fundamentalist-modernist controversy, denominational distinctives were much more clearly recognized and understood. After this, they began to be folded together. Such clarity that defined Lutheranism as opposed to Baptist or Anglicans as opposed to Methodist, such clarity began to dissipate. It followed these controversies with the rise of a new generation of evangelicals in the middle of the 20th century, primarily gathered around the preaching ministry of Billy Graham. During this time, evangelicals begin to come together. Francis Schaeffer, Carl Henry, Kenneth Conser, a whole host of others, Harold Lindzell, Wilbur Smith, they all began to come together around this new movement that found its identity, particularly in 1957 at the New York Graham Crusade, which was pivotal in defining the movement. At that particular time, Grant Wacker says that Billy Graham became America's pastor. Harold Ockingay and Carl F. H. Henry focused on central core beliefs as a way of undergirding the work of Billy Graham, emphasizing cooperation, scholarship, and cultural engagement. In the 1960s, the mainline denominations had seemingly lost their way, living in a time of racial unrest, protests, rock and roll celebrations, love-ins and sit-ins amidst the sexual revolution. The mainline denomination shifted their focus away from the gospel to social issues like the Vietnam War, civil rights, a dominant focus on gender and sexuality, with proposals by Harvey Cox and John A.T. Roberts and Thomas Altizer suggesting that the death of God had come. Continued focus of the mainline on other issues other than the gospel, having the words of Russell Chandler, the former editor, religion editor of the Los Angeles Times, moved mainline Protestantism to the sidelines for the 21st century, and into that stepped the broad evangelical movement, which was shaped in the middle of the 20th century. So evangelicalism has a long history. It has been shaped by pietism, Puritanism, by revival movements, by controversies, always with the desire to make something better, to renew something that was not renewed enough, to make something more spiritual that was not enough, and largely from a heartfelt perspective. It is that movement that many of us know from our churches. It is that movement that many of us know from our upbringing. But I would like to suggest that, understood in light of the history of the church at large for 2,000 years, that is not enough to sustain evangelicalism or to sustain Christian higher education in the 21st century. So I want to move our comments a bit and try to direct them to asking the question, how does tradition and scholarship and research influence this evangelical movement? Certainly then, as we have seen, personal faith and genuine Christian piety are essential for the life of Christ followers, for the church, for the work of evangelical higher education. Helping students recognize the importance of serious thinking about God, Scripture, the church, tradition, and the world needs a renewed emphasis at this time in order for the truth claims of the Christian faith to be passed along to the next generation. We cannot merely assume that one's personal, pietistic, and private experience will be passed along to the next generation. Different questions are being asked, and Christian higher education must step in and reprioritize its calling to see afresh how the Christian faith shapes how we live, how we think, how we write books, how we govern society, how we relate to one another in our churches, in our societal structures. The richness of the Christian tradition provides guidance for the complex challenges facing Christian higher education at this time. I believe that an appeal to tradition is not only timely, but that it meets an important need, because the secular culture in which we find ourselves is at best indifferent to the Christian faith and trying to marginalize it at worst. And the Christian world, at least in its most popular form, tends to be confused about its beliefs, its heritage, its tradition associated with the Christian faith. The world in which we live, with its emphasis on diversity and plurality, may well be a creative setting for what Thomas Oden refers to as a paleo-orthodoxy. Here we ground our unity not only in the biblical confession that Jesus is Lord, but in the great confessional tradition flowing from the early church councils. The so-called postmodern world could indeed become a rich context for recovering a classical view of the Christian tradition that will enliven all aspects of our research and scholarship that we talked about this morning across the disciplines. The current educational emphasis on the interrelationship of all things allows us to speak intelligently of the Christian message historically and globally. Such historical confessions, though neither infallible nor completely sufficient, can provide wisdom and guidance, helping us find balance for the mandates that face us for right Christian thinking, right Christian believing, and right Christian living. At the heart of this calling is the need to prepare a generation of Christians to think Christianly, to engage the academy and the culture, to serve society, and to renew the connection with the church and its mission. To do so, the breadth and depth of the Christian tradition will need to be reclaimed, renewed, revitalized, and revived for the good of evangelical higher education. And one place where we can come together, where we can find a beginning point, is with the key commitments of the Nicene tradition. The Creed of Nicaea was drafted to refute the claim that Jesus was the highest creation of God and thus different in essence from the Father. This was in the early decades of the 4th century. What we today refer to as the Nicene Creed was most likely approved not at Nicaea in 325, but at Constantinople in 381. And while articulating the importance of the unity of the Holy Trinity, it insisted that Christ was begotten from the Father before all time, declaring that Christ is of the same essence with the Father. And when we contend today that Christian higher education must be distinctive, Christ-centered higher education, we are in effect confessing that Jesus Christ, who was eternally the second person of the Trinity, sharing all the divine attributes, became fully human. Thus, to think of Christ-centeredness only in terms of personal piety or activism resulting from following the teachings of Jesus, while important, will be inadequate to sustain evangelical higher education for the 21st century. A healthy future for this approach to education must return to the past with the full affirmation that when we point to Jesus, we see the whole man Jesus and say, "That is God." This is the great mystery of godliness, God manifested in the flesh, in the words of Paul in 1 Timothy chapter 3. It is necessary that Christ should be both God and man, for only as a man could he be the redeemer for humanity, and only as a sinless man could he fittingly die for others. Only as God could his life, ministry, and redeeming death have infinite value and satisfy the demands of God so as to deliver us from death. Any attempt to envision a faithful evangelical higher education for the days ahead that is not tightly tethered to the great confessional tradition of the church will most likely result in an educational model without a compass. And we can call for new research, a new scholarship, a new heart of piety, but if we lack this grounding, we will have an educational model without a compass. And the only way to counter the secular assumptions that shape so many sectors of higher education today is with the confession that the exalted Christ, who spoke the world into being by his powerful word, is the providential sustainer of all of life and therefore connects all the disciplines across any campus on the country. As we seek to bring the Christian faith to bear upon the learning process and the work of distinctive evangelical higher education, our strategy must involve bringing these truths about Jesus Christ to bear upon the great ideas of history as well as the cultural and educational issues of our day. In doing so, we will seek to adjust the cultural assumptions of our post-Christian context in light of God's eternal truth. We therefore want to call for the work of higher education in the days ahead to take place through the lenses of the Nicene tradition that recognizes not only the unity of the Holy Trinity, but the transcendent, creating, sustaining, and self-disclosing Trinitarian God who has made humans in His image. And therefore, we have rationality and spirituality and the opportunity to relate to God. We envision a future for evangelical higher education that seeks to engage all subject matter and the issues of our day in the various areas of learning while recognizing that the Trinitarian God, the source of all truth, is central to the study of every discipline on this campus and every Christian college or university around the globe. This aspiration involves not only the study itself, but also the motivation for teaching and learning, for research and scholarship. For it's the uniting of the Christian tradition with learning that helps us find the essence of Christian higher education today. This is the call for the second decade of the 21st century, for the present and the future, a call where all teaching and all learning, all research and all scholarship take place with a view toward reality found only in the grandeur and glory of God made known to us in Jesus Christ. It is the Nicene tradition, then, that maintains that the church is one, holy, universal, and apostolic. The church's oneness includes unity with one another, visible and invisible. While the ultimate holiness of God's people will not take place until the consummation of God's redemptive program, a confession of the holiness of the church is a reminder for God's people to be visibly holy in spite of its present sinfulness. In the meantime, we long for oneness among God's people, even as we seek to be tolerant with one another's weaknesses and shortcomings. Confessing the church as universal points to the need to be inclusive of all branches of the Christian tradition, rather than to maintain an exclusivistic view that only one branch contains the whole truth. Also, it points to the church's universal mission to take the gospel to all the nations. Apostolicity recognizes that the church must remain faithful to the normative nature of apostolic doctrine and practice. So while evangelical colleges and universities are not local churches, one of the reasons they exist is to serve the church as the church's academic arm. And it is here that our work in research and scholarship serves the church at large. We need to think fresh about the relationship of Christian higher education to the church, for it is central to God's working in history. The church is not only central to history, but to the gospel and to Christian living as well. For these reasons, the early years of Christian higher education placed their focus first in terms of service for and to the churches. It is a vision to which we need to return. As we seek to envision a future for evangelical higher education, we would do well to recover the priority of connecting our institutions in renewed ways to the churches across this land. James Burchell, in his important work, The Dying of the Light, has surveyed dozens of institutions across various traditions, focusing on the 19th and 20th century examples. Burchell may well be wrong about some of the particulars that he discusses relating to some of these specific institutions, and I think he is. But he is overwhelmingly right about the one overarching aspect of his thesis. The moment institutions start to lose the connection with the church is the day the light begins to die on their campus. So let me again say that Christian colleges, evangelical universities, are not churches. They do things different than churches, and they do things differently than churches. Still, Christian institutions are an extension of the church, the academic arm. Thus, Christ-centered colleges and universities must not only remain connected to the churches, but also reflect the characteristics of the church. So, we must think in terms of the four characteristics of oneness and holiness and universality and apostolicity as ways of defining our research and scholarship and teaching and service on our campuses. Just prior to his crucifixion, Jesus prayed for the unity of his followers. The prayer was not only for Jesus' immediate followers, but for the church through the ages, which means that his prayer has application for our context as well. His prayer was for believers today who reflect the words of that high priestly prayer in John's gospel, which is a prayer for unity and a prayer for truth, which brings about a holy uniqueness and a unique holiness for our work. In verses 20 through 26 of that chapter, we read that Jesus prayed that his followers would experience and manifest a spiritual unity that exemplifies the oneness of the Father with the Son. In spite of our many differences, we belong to the same Lord and thus to each other. Yet far too often we are characterized by controversy, infighting, fragmentation, selfishness, and disunity. We not only look to this passage in the Gospel of John, but in Ephesians chapter 4, but also to the Nicene tradition itself. So let us once again point to a future for evangelical higher education where we work together toward oneness, holiness, universality, and apostolicity. We call for a universality that crosses all geographical, economic, racial, and ethnic lines. We appeal for a oneness that is founded on the person and work of Jesus Christ and the common salvation we share in Him. One of the things that will authenticate the message of the gospel and our shared and collaborative work in evangelical higher education is the way that we love each other and relate to each other, living and serving together in harmony. It is this witness that our Lord wants and expects from us in the world so that the world may believe that the Father has sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. So as we envision a hopeful future, a different kind of future where piety alone will not sustain the work, we envision a new work for the shared efforts of evangelical higher education. We in no way want to be naive to the multifaceted changes and multi-level challenges all around us. Technological, economic, educational, denominational, cultural. Our focus in this brief talk this afternoon, however, has not been to try to address all the particulars of those challenges. Rather, it has been to focus on the central and foundational commitments that are needed to envision and sustain a faithful future for evangelical higher education, where we need to learn to work together in new and collaborative ways. We will need both confessional conviction and a fresh spirit of cooperation to build bridges toward shared efforts. We'll need to understand the value of tradition that can both inform and shape an intergenerational, intercultural, transdenominational, and transcontinental approach to Christian higher education. We'll need a new spirit of trust, of mutual respect and humility to serve together with those with whom we have differences on secondary and tertiary matters. It's very possible to hold hands together with brothers and sisters who disagree on less important matters and work together for the common good to extend the work of the gospel and the distinctives of evangelical higher education for our day. New opportunities for partnership and collaboration need to pull us out of our inward-focused insularity, particularly where we can serve together in cultural engagement, religious freedom, and other matters involving the public square. We need to trust God to bring a fresh wind of His Spirit, to bring renewal to our confessional convictions, to strengthen our commitments to a distinctive Christ-centered education, and to revitalize our connections with service to the church through our teaching, service, research, and scholarship. So let us pray that we can relate to one another in love and humility, bringing new life to our shared efforts. We pray not only for renewed confessional convictions, but as we concluded this morning, also for a genuine orthodoxy that can be seen before a watching world. A world particularly in the Western Hemisphere that stands on the verge of giving up on the very Christian faith we proclaim. We trust that our collaborative efforts then in the work of evangelical higher education will bring about renewal in our calling to research and scholarship, the work between students and faculty, faculty with faculty, institutions with other institutions in the days to come that will bring forth fruit that will strengthen partnerships, alliances, and networks for the extension of God's kingdom on this earth and for the eternal glory of our great God. I believe that there is a great and hopeful future for evangelical higher education, but only if we think of it more broadly than simply our pietistic or revivalistic tradition. We must think more broadly and we must think more deeply. And I trust that a call to research and scholarship will find a home here at Liberty University, and you'll help us lead the way for the days to come. God's blessings upon you.
Thank you for that lecture. We're going to give you guys a chance to ask a few questions. I want to lead off with a question as you're thinking about some questions, and that is one of the things you talked about, Dr. Dockery, was bringing everything under the banner of Christ in higher education. What are some practical ways at Union and at Trinity you've helped to kind of, the word that's often used around here, silos, and get people out of silos and have these conversations and these collaboration? I think in particular, coming out of the theology and apologetics and cultural engagement, we're prone to just naturally think of our discipline, hopefully, in that way. But I know as I've been working with colleagues, and some of them are, you know, coming from Ohio State, and they're thinking about their discipline and been trained to think about English or the sciences there, sometimes we have trouble connecting. And so how have you done this at Union and Trinity?
I mentioned this morning a reference when someone was asking about books to read, that I suggest the work of Peter Berger, the sociologist at Boston University, who I think has his hand on the pulse of American life just about as well as anyone. And he says that there are four shaping influences that are coming together at this particular time to converge and create the culture that we see in front of us. And they are the streams of privatization, pluralization, secularization, resulting in the loss of plausibility structures. Let me see if I can unpack that just a bit. Privatization means that if we have a Christian faith at all, it is something that's only private between ourselves and God. It's not something that dares enter into the public arena. Pluralization says that there is a place for every kind of faith and belief, and there is not one better than the other, and there's really no way to distinguish one over against the other. Secularization is what he calls the removal of the sacred canopy, and that no longer do we approach life or higher education with the standpoint that there is a supreme being, a theistic, providential God over all things. And the result of that is the loss of plausibility structures, which means that we now have a world in which we can't quite put life together because no one around us is able to do so, and their family is falling apart, or their job is falling apart, or their life is falling apart, or they lack a coherent way of seeing things, and so there's not a combined coherent way of seeing the world. But it's particularly the one that we might think is the least important that is the most important to understand to answer your question. We often talk about the importance of pluralism and secularization, and we start to push back on those. But I think it's the emphasis of privatization. Because in privatization, what happens is people in higher education find a way to kind of keep their faith alive, but it sits over here in a corner all by itself. And it never touches where we live and think and breathe and how we relate one to another. As a matter of fact, it affects not only higher education, it affects the business world as well. Ray Kroc, the founder of McDonald's, gave an interview in the New York Times right before he retired. And the obvious question from the journalist was this: what's the key to your success and the great advancement of this company? And he said, I think it's the priorities of my life, which sounded great at the time. And the follow-up question was, what are those priorities? And here was his answer. They are God, family, and McDonald's. But in the office, the order is reversed. And I think most scholars in higher education come the same way. They come with a commitment to God. They go to church on Sunday. They love their family, but they love economics. They love sociology. They love English literature. And they can't quite find a way to bring those things together. And so their discipline, their scholarship over here, sits separated from the rest of life. And so one of the ways we can work together is to ask the question that you've asked. How do we bring our discipline under the Lordship of Christ? And here's what I think the answer is. There's not a one-size-fits-all for every discipline. And therefore, we have to think more specifically discipline to discipline. And so when we go next door to this music building, we have to think in terms of a God of beauty and what that means for us. And we understand God from the attributes of beauty. We go across the way to the science building. We ask a different kind of question. When we go to the sociology classroom, we start not necessarily with the God of beauty, but with the fallenness of humanity. And so we help connect discipline to discipline, doctrine to discipline. And that way, we move outside of seeing this work of theology over here and our disciplines over here, but we begin to make some dotted line connections under this umbrella that all knowledge has its source in God and Jesus Christ is Lord of all things. But I think it has to be done in particular applications and with a very intentional understanding to move faith away from the sphere of privatized understanding into a place in which it can participate in a broader public conversation on a campus that then can move off of that campus into the public square.
That's great. I often find that it's more comfortable for us as theologians to talk systematic theology than to have to go across the hall, talk to the sociologist about what they're doing and listen and try to integrate. And on the other hand, it's more comfortable for the sociologist to stick over there and not try to bring theology into it.
It'll require some very intentional cross-disciplinary conversations and some efforts to work together, as I said, on our campuses and campus to campus.
Some questions from you guys. If you can speak up, and then Dr. Dockery will repeat what you said.
Yeah, I think it does, because we tend to think, when we talk about being Christ-centered, my experience is that it comes across only in terms of a personal kind of, you know, I'm using pietistic in a negative sense, even though I don't mean for every aspect of it to be that way, but in a personal kind of heart religion toward God, or in only following the teachings of Christ that move us to activism and social activity. And what that does is it has a place then for hands and heart, but not for head. And so what the putting the Christ-centeredness back in the Nicene tradition, where we have to understand who this Christ is and the implications for one who is very God of very God, then that has intellectual understandings for unpacking the significance of who Christ is in light of our study of economics, in light of our study of English, in light of our study of business, in light of our study of biology. And so I think if we think in terms of connecting head, heart, and hands, it forces us to engage the tradition and the theological significance of who Christ is. It's very easy to claim to be Christ-centered on campuses like ours and focus only on a place for campus ministry, chapel, heartfelt religion, or mission trips, or social projects that we work on with our hands, neglect the head altogether. The result is that this second generation after that may assume what the previous generation thought about Christ. The third generation will lose it entirely. So the heart and the hands are not enough to sustain the Christian faith, and so we must go back to the very heart of that tradition.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I think it's an excellent question. If I understand it, you're asking how does church and institution work together where the institution functions as the academic arm of the church and its implications more broadly. And it connects with this question, I think, the prior question, because our tendency in churches and don't misunderstand this, because this is foundational and basic, essential, necessary, the first step for everyone, is to focus on the spiritual growth, the development of personal disciplines, of Bible reading and prayer and fellowship, and those are you can't grow in the Christian faith. You cannot make progress. A church cannot mature without those things. But most what we fail to do, and it connects all three questions really, is we fail to show the person who's going into counseling office on Monday morning, who's going into the healthcare unit on Monday morning, who's going into the business office on Monday morning, who's going to coach the sports team on Monday morning, who's going to, you know, paint the beautiful picture or do the photography on Monday morning. We don't do a very good job of helping them understand how all of those things connect. And so it comes back to doing it step by step and discipline by discipline. And so we can make some general statements like I made this afternoon, that we want to connect all these things under the Lordship of Christ, and that's a first step to helping people begin to do it. But I think it takes some pretty intentional study groups, some pretty intentional mentoring programs, some pretty intentional kind of relationship development. So what you do is get the business person to ask the pastor, theologian, you know, how do we connect these things? It's more than just being ethical in the way we do business. That's important, you know, that's the first step, but it's more than that. You actually begin to think about how you use business to care for your employees. You actually see your business as something that makes a contribution to society, to the community, to culture. You see your business as something that can be built up, that can make a difference in the global world of the 21st century. You deal with the artist by, again, helping them see the God who is the God of beauty, and therefore a God who loves and admires and wants us to see the art world, the music world flourish, and to see artists flourish. And to make beautiful things for the glory of God. But it requires a two-way conversation. And I think where the church, and I'll speak of myself, I'm not speaking about someone, I'm speaking where we in the church have not done a good job is listening to the questions coming from these disciplines. We've just tried to speak to them. And so if we hear the question, the struggles, the issues in healthcare, if we hear about the issues in the marketplace, then I think we can create a two-way conversation that helps the church speak to these things. But the step behind that, to get to your question, is the church often wants to help but doesn't know how. And so what the church needs is the educator in the business world, the educator in the healthcare world, the educator in the sociology world, the educator in the psychology world, who can then help the person in the church be prepared to help the lay people in their Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday world. And so it's without the institutions serving as the educational arm for the church, usually the church can only do the minimal things, and therefore people really are never helped and the dots are never really connected. So we have to have, you know, multiple way conversations, and institutions serving the church serving the institution, with the goal of helping people live and be live out their Christian faith Monday through Saturday, not just in living well, but in making their discipline, their work, matter for the cause of Christ, that create flourishing communities and whole families and, you know, a mutual good for neighborhoods and society.
Some of the students, especially some resources, as you were talking about what it looks like for Christ to be Lord over different disciplines, and no matter where you stand on soteriology, I would still recommend reading some of the Dutch Reformed tradition on this, because they've done some very good thinking. Alvin Plantinga, Walter Storff, and I've recently read James K. Smith's new book, You Are What You Love, and he has a nice little chapter on this towards the end. So for you students, if your first kind of taste of some of this, if you haven't heard of this language, that might be a good place to start if you're thinking through this. I don't know if you wanted to add to any of that or if you had some recommendations as well.
I think James K. A. Smith is a good place to start, and you might even back up one and read How Not to Be Secular, so that you understand the secular world in which we pretty much have imbibed without even knowing it, so that you learn how not to be secular first before you take his next step of the most recent book, which is the constructive application of that into the context.
Yeah, and read those before next spring, because he's going to be on campus for another one of these kind of lecture series. So, Dr. Dockery, thank you so much for being with us today. Let's give him a round of applause. And just one more note, we have the Faith and Culture lecture series tonight with Dr. Fowler, 7:00 in the Science Auditorium, so please join us for that. Thanks again, and have a blessed rest of your day. Thanks.